Good afternoon, all. Thanks for joining us today in this panel discussion. My name is Waseem Shah, and I welcome all of you on behalf of our One Learning team to join this panel discussion with us today. I think the journey has been really, great so far. Right after we kicked off our last discussion, on 17th of May. There has been a lot of feedback we have been receiving from all across the world. Some are good, of course, and then, there are, at the same time, there are some opportunity areas as well. And that is anyways the part and parcel of the journey, because this is something, what we call, that evolution, which is a consistent process. And I think without that, it's not just that business that we would not be left with. I think also as an individual, if we don't evolve. So that's a great opportunity for us. So again, we really thank for those feedback, because it takes time, to write those pieces and bits and then, try to send it to us. So really thank you for that. Today the topic that we have chosen is, basis the demand and the popularity. This was one of those shows for which we had received so many, demands from the people that we, there should be something around this. And we tried to, connect all our gurus who will be taking you through all these pieces together today. And this is how the objectives for today's session look like. I will be introducing shortly our panelists, which of course, I think it's an interesting story, because before even I introduce, there will be a lot of participants who may have joined from across the borders, who have reached us and talking about our panelists, that they know them already, they are fans of them. If I talk about, for example, Dr. Sonal, we have people from Egypt and I believe Bangladesh, right? So wherein they have connected personally with me and said, hey, when this is going to happen, because we are the fans of Dr. Sonal. And similarly, for Dr. Kuldeep, I think there is a great fan following from Dubai, Middle East, and few folks I could interact with from Singapore. And then Dr. Ladbenskor, who is actually very much famous, in the Guyana area, and a lot of people know her in the across India. But precisely, if I talk about North India, I think she stands out there. And then we have Dr. Alka. Dr. Alka is also there. So it's a bit about my experience, not about them, because there is a different slide for them. Because people have been reaching out as I handle the social media handles and all that, connecting with me and talking about them. And it was such a great, a beautiful feeling that, the audiences who are joining us, and I'm sure that they must be so excited that when I'm going to just leave and, you will just kick it off. So afterwards, we are done with the discussion. We will have a bit of One Learning, how One Learning is changing the landscape of the healthcare education. We will talk about some sounding principles, the methodologies, which are very much important. Then we'll also talk about the platform that we have created for all of you. And we will just have a walkthrough, a short walkthrough. And then finally, our panelists will, take on the questions which may be arising throughout the session. And as I said last time as well, that we'll try to take maximum questions. However, I must be telling you the fact that time is maybe a constraint. So due to that, we may try to reach out to you via other methods of communication, but we will ensure that the questions are getting answered by the same gurus who are in the panel. And then last but not the least, we will also have experience shared by our panelists today, the reason that why they connected with the One Learning, maybe of course everybody has a driving factor that's why we do one or other job. So and then we finally will wrap up. So that is how the objective for the day looks like. And then to talk a bit about our panelists, about their experience. Today we have with us the dazzling Dr. Sonal Panchal, and she's a senior consultant at sonography at Dr. Nagori's Infertility Institute. And then specialized at infertility, gynecology, and high-risk obstetrics scans. Having a rich experience of 30-plus years. And then next to that, we have the glorious Dr. Ladban Skor, consultant radiologist at Prime Diagnostic Chandigarh, and is specialized at fetal diagnostics and interventions, then transvaginal and color Doppler. Again, holding 30-plus years of experience. And next to that, we have the very passionate Dr. Kuldeep Singh, who is a consultant ultrasonologist at Dr. Kuldeep's Ultrasound and Color Doppler Clinic, which is based off in New Delhi. Dr. Kuldeep is specialized at obstetrics and gynecology, and then carrying a 25-plus years of track record in this particular field. And then last but not the least, we have the delightful Dr. Alka Singhal, who is Associate Director Radiology at Medanta Medicity, which most of us know because it's a very well-known healthcare hospital. And Dr. Alka is specialized at Doppler neck parathyroid, MSK, obstetrics, gynae, 3D, 4D, and all sort of ultrasounds. And again, 25 plus years of experience in the industry. I could just cover a bit of it, because if I just go with everything that they have done, which includes their accomplishments, their awards, their books, just for up with the international platforms, how they are connecting the dots, and how they have been influencers in different facets of the technology and the application part of it. I think that's something we are running short of time. That would not be possible at the moment. But again, each of them, we have created a sort of playbook, which is which you can find on our website, One Learning Healthcare. And you may also take a flavor of that personalized touch, wherein you can not only know about their accomplishments and awards and all, but that will also talk about their interests, their hobbies, what they like in their part time. So that's a detailed overview that you can go through to have that personal touch with each one of them, because it's very, very important to break that ice, to break the barriers, and to meet those minds and hearts to collaborate. I think that would be much beneficial for each of you, because it's open to everybody. You can just get to the website and see what all about them. So with that, without taking any more time, I'm sure the fans are pretty much excited and waiting for that when the discussion kicks off. So I would like to hand it over from here to Dr. Sonal. If you could please do the honors, please take it up from here. Over to you.
Thank you, Vaseem. And it is, thank you very much for those kind words and introduction of all my speakers, all my panelists. Friends, it's a pleasure to be with you all again. And today we are going to do a panel discussion on ectopic pregnancy and its complications. And you have already met all my learned panelists, Dr. Kuldeep Singh, Dr. Ladban Skor, and Dr. Alka Singhal. We all know that whenever the pregnancy, the gestational sac, is not implanted into the endometrial fundus, that is when we say it is implanted ectopically, and that is an ectopic pregnancy. It may occur anywhere in the entire genital tract, the commonest being the tube. And of course, in the tube also, it may implant in the femoral and the ampullary region or isthmic region, or also in the interstitium of the tube. it may be an angular pregnancy. So in the angles of the uterus, it may be in the cervix, it may be in the cesarean scar, it may be in the ovary, and quite rare, but it may be free lying in the abdomen also. The diagnosis of ectopic pregnancy is important because we know that these pregnancies have abnormal outcomes. Some of them may carry on till the third trimester or near term, but there are some others which react as severe maternal complications very early during pregnancy. And therefore, early diagnosis of these pregnancies are important. They can reduce the fatality by about 75%. So if you say early diagnosis is to be done, it has to be suspected first. And therefore, it's said that if you think ectopic, you diagnose ectopic. So, should I start with Dr. Kuldeep Singh? When does one suspect an ectopic pregnancy in a patient?
When you're thinking of basically somebody's missed out on a period and she's come to you with a beta HCG which is positive, you're going to be doing a scan. But before that, the symptoms that are going to be telling you that you could be thinking of an ectopic is vaginal spotting. You're looking at irregular vaginal bleeding. Anybody with a period of amenorrhea, she's missed a period and abdominal pain and bleeding. First thing is it could be an ectopic. And God forbid this should not happen, but if there's a vasomotor shock and fainting, we had it, we need to be acting very, very fast on that. So that's how you're going to be looking and thinking of an ectopic.
Okay, so can you tell us, Dr. Lodbans, do we have any clues on the clinical examination before we do a scan?
Certainly, ma'am. In a hemodynamically stable patient, we will have the examination of the patient would show tenderness in the lower abdomen. And in an unstable patient could just present with tachycardia, hypotension, and on examination, you may have shifting dullness, right? Abdominal distension is there. Then on PS, of course, as the patient is coming with vaginal bleeding, you could have bloodstained discharge. And on PV, there is tender fornices. We call it cervical excitation test is positive. That means that happens. So when we do an ultrasound, the probe itself causes such a painful, that gives you a hint. Yes, maybe we are looking at ectopic. So that is what is called a cervical excitation test.
That's when you actually start thinking ectopic.
And there has been a situation in our clinic that there has been ladies coming, walking, and suddenly collapses on the ground.
Yeah.
Please think of ectopic. Even before putting the probe inside, we have to think that it is ectopic. And there it was.
Yeah, and that's very right. Fainting in otherwise a normal woman who has missed her period is very common presentation of ectopic, and that slightest leak of blood touching the peritoneum would give that attack.
Absolutely.
Okay, so Dr. Alka, if we have these findings, then are we sure that it is an ectopic clinically, or there is a differential diagnosis possible?
There is a whole range of differential diagnoses. The gynecology, the commonest is self-angiitis, and then ovarian torsion clearly overlaps with symptomatology. You can have corpus luteal rupture, endometritis, and spontaneously abortion can present with pain and spotting and bleeding and very much painful. Comparing to looking at abdominal emergencies, appendicitis is a common confusing element in cases of pain in the right iliac fossa. Vena polyps are another common confusing element. So again, less commonly we also see diverticulitis overlapping with the symptomatology and mesenteric lymphadenitis or just bowel infection and other mistakes overlap.
So that means it mimics any abdominal emergency, right?
Right.
And therefore, we know that it is a positive beta HCG with a missed period that narrows down the range of possible diagnosis. So if the beta HCG is positive, and at what range of that or with what behavior of its would you suspect that it is an ectopic pregnancy, Dr. Kulbi?
You're going to be first and foremost thinking of she's short of her periods, but the way the beta HCG should be, it's a little lower than what it's supposed to be. It's going to strike you, it could be. Before you put in a probe, always a good idea to look at the beta HCG reports. Then if you're not able to find out something, you're not able to look at an intrauterine pregnancy, nothing at the adnexa, a beta HCG is again called for serial evaluation, and you're going to be getting it done after 2 days or 48 hours. And it does not increase the way it should be, at least it should double or should go more than 60%. Then that is when again you're going to start to think of, might be it's an ectopic. We have this discriminatory zone of less than and more than 1500. And the moment you're looking at a value which is more than 1500, and we're going to discuss it in a few slides later, if it's more than 1500 and you're not looking at an intrauterine pregnancy, she's not bleeding, it should be an ectopic pregnancy unless and until proved otherwise. And we still need to be aware, you could still be missing out on an ectopic with a normal beta HCG evaluation. It's increasing serially properly, but you could still be looking at later that it turns out to be an ectopic pregnancy. So the complete range you need to be careful of, you need to think ectopic, you need to be looking out for it in the adnexa very carefully.
Brilliant. I cannot move forward. Wasim, can you help please? I cannot move forward. My slides are not going forward.
Sure, ma'am. Let me just try that.
You can unshare your screen and then again start sharing, ma'am. Let's see whether that helps.
My slideshow.
Dr. Kuldeep, maybe you can share.
I'll do that. I'll do that, ma'am. You go ahead with the next question. Not a problem, ma'am. We'll plan it out. Don't worry.
Okay, I'm talking. I don't know whether I'm seen or not, okay?
No, you're seen, ma'am.
Yeah, perfect. Then we do always wait for the beta HCG to reach to 1500 international units in that case, Dr. Kuldeep?
See, what we need to remember always is that the beta HCG is not going to be increasing the way it should be in a normal pregnancy. So by the time you're looking for an ectopic and it reaching 1500 means that if it would have been an intrauterine, it would have been around 2400, 2500 units. So you need to keep that in mind that even if it is not 1500, you still have to be watchful. That should not be an excuse for missing out on ectopic. I'm looking at 1200 or 1300, so I didn't suspect it. No. Let it be 800, let it be 1100. You need to be carefully watching out on the adnexa, not missing out on a diagnosis of ectopic. Sometimes just a small adnexal swelling and you can start thinking on it. So rather than telling them to come back after 48 hours or after even more, you can always tell them to come back a little earlier. So
perfect.
That way we can follow it up.
If you have a missed period, you have a positive beta HCG and a week has elapsed and you think that the beta HCG levels are low, you must do a scan and examine, right?
Absolutely.
I can share my screen. My PPT is working. Should I share?
Whichever way. I've also opened mine, but you can do that, G. Please. That'll be ideal.
I can actually.
Is my screen showing? Ma'am, you have to come out of the presentation mode.
Yeah, I know, but it doesn't, there also it is hanged. It doesn't go out.
Mine is working.
Yeah, you can
go ahead with the...
This is your screen, right?
Yes, my Dr. Alka, my screen.
Perfect.
And you can continue.
Go further. Okay. Please go further.
So,
please go further.
Dr.
I've answered that question. Gee, that's perfect.
Please go further.
So, yeah.
Okay. So that question goes to the previous one.
Dr. Lardner.
I think if you don't mind, I will just like to rejoin, and my participants, please excuse me for that.
Please, ma'am, whichever way.
It will not be convenient if I just keep on saying next and first. Anyway, let us try for a while. Will you get any other hormonal investigation done, or you just depend on the beta-HCG?
No, we can certainly go ahead and do a progesterone level.
Yeah. You
know, that helps in differentiating a viable intrauterine pregnancy from a low level of progesterone, where it is seen in cases of non-viable pregnancies as well as ectopic pregnancy.
Next.
So what is very important, it actually acts as a prognosticating serum test for ectopic. In a way, I should put it that way, that the analysis of progesterone can identify two important groups of women in the emergency room. See, a patient comes to us with vaginal bleeding, pain, tenderness, immediately do a progesterone level. If the progesterone level is more than 50, that means you are going to look for an intrauterine pregnancy. That holds true when you're looking for, when you don't see anything in the uterus or in the adnexa. So that means there are things which are going to come up in the intrauterine pregnancy, in the uterus, vis-a-vis those women which have a lower level of progesterone, less than 5. So that means you are going to look at something like failed intrauterine gestation or an ectopic pregnancy. So immediately it helps you to differentiate these two particular important conditions, so that is how you can actually act. If you have to do something like DNC, you can avoid once you have a higher level of progesterone, right? Whereas you can go ahead and do your methotrexate or systemic or local injection, whatever. This progesterone helps you to actually prognosticate ectopic pregnancy.
So it's like beta-HCG is about 1,000, and we do not see the intrauterine gestational sac, and we're not seeing anything in the adnexa also. In these cases, it is very important to understand that if we do a progesterone label, so if that happens, it becomes a pregnancy of unknown location. And that is where it makes you restless for the management, because you do not know what is going to happen and how soon the patient is going to go in an emergency. In that case, if the progesterone levels are less than 5 nanograms per ml, that means it is a low risk patient, and you can allow the patient to go home, educate her about the symptoms, and let her come back when she develops symptoms or after 48 hours. If the progesterone level is more than 5, so between 5 and 50, it's a wide range, but that is the range where you have to be very, very careful. The patient has to be in a close observation. That's very true. So that means that with HCG, with progesterone, it gives you a guideline, but the diagnostic is the transvaginal sonography. And if I'm talking of this transvaginal sonography, we know that it has a very high sensitivity and specificity for the diagnosis of ectopic pregnancy. Can you see the next slide? It is a combination of the clinical parameters, the HCG, and of course the transvaginal scan. All three together has 100% sensitivity for the diagnosis of an ectopic pregnancy, in a specificity of as high as 99%. So that means we all know that if we are seeing, I need to play that. So if we are seeing an adnexal mass which has a yolk sac, which has a cardiac activity there, we are all sure this is an ectopic pregnancy, where this is a diagnosis for anybody. But if we have to diagnose it early, what are the signs?
Diagnose it early, we look at the signs in the uterus. We have a thickened endometrium. The normal uterine findings of thickened endometrium, asymmetry of endometrium, and a focal hypervascular area may not be seen in cases of ectopic pregnancy. Instead, what we see in ectopic pregnancy is an empty uterine cavity, which may or may not show any increased endometrial thickness due to any residual reaction, and there are symmetrical endometrial lips on the other side of the collapsed endometrial cavity. At times, in about 10 to 20% cases, we can see a pseudogestational sac, which is kind of a small fluid-filled sac area into the endometrial cavity. So this is just a recap. So what we see in a normal pregnancy, normal implantation, the endometrium is acogenic. There is asymmetric thickening of the endometrium, and there is a local focal area of thickened of hyperperfusion in the endometrial lining. That is very suggestive of an intrauterine implantation. So we don't see, and instead, if we see a pseudogestational sac, Dr. Lajwant, how do we figure this out?
It's since it is seen in such a small percentage of women with ectopic pregnancy, it is very important to differentiate the pseudogestational sac from the true gestational sac. Now, the pseudogestational sac is a central fluid collection. I'm not seeing the slides. So,
Alka, you have to start sharing again, please. I was just trying about mine, but I cannot.
Anyway, I can speak without that. So, pseudogestational sac is a centrally placed fluid collection in the endometrial cavity. And the most important thing is that it will not show the signs of a true gestational sac. The signs of a true gestational sac are an intradecidual sac sign, where the sac, the true gestational sac, is embedded eccentrically into the subendometrial region, producing an intradecidual sac sign, and also it shows a double decidual sac sign. So you will not have an echogenic rim around the pseudogestational sac. One. Secondly, you could also see some changing shape. It is not as ovoid and as spherical as you see with the true gestational sac. So it could change shape, and even if you just, you know, push upon the uterus or the cervix gently, it can change its shape. And even with the uterine contractions, it is seen to change its shape, especially the pseudogestational sac. And on color Doppler or a power Doppler, since it's a pseudogestational sac, it will not show any vascularity, the peritrophoblastic vascularity, which is seen with the true gestational sac.
Perfect, perfect.
Great. And second, a true gestational sac could also show you a yolk sac.
Yeah. If you are, that is when it is grown up. Is,
yeah, when it is grown up. That is close to 5.5 weeks of pregnancy.
Okay, now I cannot forward it.
You can also not forward it.
Okay.
So, okay, let us do this. I will not see the screen, but hopefully I can probably go further. If there is a problem with my vision, you can tell me. Otherwise, I can continue with the presentation, okay? So, what are the adnexal signs in a tubal pregnancy, Dr. Kuldeep?
It's moving, ma'am.
It's fine. This is fine now. Don't disturb it, please. That's okay.
Perfect. So what we're looking at in terms of an adnexal signs, if you're able to look in at a gestational sac, you're very, very happy. You're able to look in at a yolk sac and an embryo, you're absolutely comfortable. There is no element of doubt, but that does not happen always. In fact, that's what's mentioned. It happens only in 15 to 28% of pregnancies. What are you going to be looking at? Nothing in the uterus, and you're looking at an adnexal mass. If you're not thinking of a heterotopic pregnancy, you're going to be looking at a thick echogenic rim. You're going to be looking at a central anechoic area. The mass could be inhomogeneous, could show that ring of fire. So you need to be careful that you're not looking at a corpus luteum and claiming it to be an ectopic. Be careful on that. So you're looking at the corpus luteum separate, the mass separate. You could be looking at free fluid in the pouch of Douglas in the retrouterine space. Then even if it's much earlier, you could be looking at just an isoechoic mass, which is going to be showing increased vascularity. So that's a catch, and you need to be well aware of it. You're not going to be looking at a gestational sac always, just a mass, which is again not inhomogeneous, has just started evolving, and you could be missing out. So that index of suspicion, think ectopic, should always be there.
Perfect. That's great. That means the message goes that even if you are seeing an isoechoic extra ovarian at an axial mass with a peripheral rim in a patient who has a missed period and positive beta HCG, that's when you should start thinking of ectopic. If you get a gestational sac and then you're diagnosing, you're pretty late. Yes. And the second important point that Dr. Kuldeep also pointed out is you may see free fluid. That means even if you don't see free fluid, the free fluid starts appearing, either it's a reactionary or because of the blood collecting when the tubal wall starts breaking up. So even before that, the ectopic could be diagnosed. Perfect. That is really, really great. And there are some pictures of ectopic and we go further.
Who has the control of the screen so one can move the arrow and show the images over there? What exactly do they say?
It's me. So here, this is important. You have two lesions here. One typically shows a hemorrhagic fluid inside and the outer margin is not at all hyperechoic. This is a slightly irregular anechoic area, but the outer margin is hyperechoic. You're also seeing the ovarian tissue here. And this lesion is extra ovarian. So this is an ectopic and that is a corpus luteum. Similarly, this though has a hyperechoic mass there, but it is intra ovarian and that's an extra ovarian mass here. So this is an ectopic mass and you should be able to diagnose it as early as this. Dr. Kuldeep has rightly pointed out that it may be just an inhomogeneous mass with no central anechogenicity and still it's an ectopic pregnancy. Okay, so if the 2D picture, if at all, it is not very confirmatory, you do a Doppler. Is Doppler a help? Is 3D a help to us, Dr. Alka?
Yes, color and dark, Doppler and 3D are definitely helpful in resolving in critical cases. So when we put the color and the power Doppler on with appropriate sensitivity settings, we can adequately demonstrate the vascular rim around the mass and tiny little vessels go into the mass. And this extent of hypervascularity is corresponding to the extent of the trophoblastic activity and the invasiveness. So it gives us an idea. And when we can also quantify this, when we can put the spectral Doppler on, we can measure the RI values because there is an abundant diastolic flow. RI values are like 0.5, 4.5 or 0.43. And we can also do 3D ultrasound. So in cases of early cases, we can demonstrate the swollen fallopian tube with the two sacs inside. And this can be very diagnostic in cases of very early ectopic before even 6 weeks of amenorrhea and in asymptomatic patients. As seen in these images, see, we have got a nice rim of vascularity around. You see the little vessels and on 3D Doppler, we can see the vessels clearly coming there and there's a lot of hypervascularity around and tiny vessels going and we talk about the leaf sign and other signs. And here again there is a sac on 3D ultrasound. We can demonstrate this is a case, a rare case seen with a fallopian tube which having two ectopic gestational sacs with it, a swollen fallopian tube with two ectopic gestations.
Perfect. So that means 3D is definitely a help and especially it is to be kept in mind that there can be tween ectopics. So clinically the gynecologists are pretty sure with their assessment and they know that they are dealing with an ectopic, but in spite of that it is essential to do a scan to find out what is the age of gestation of that ectopic and whether there's a single sac or more and what is the amount of fluid that would give them this, the idea about the seriousness of the lesion, of the pathology. And you can beautifully see here in this scan a tube and the gestational sac and here two gestational sacs with the femoral end there. So, and with blood in the uterine cavity, which tells us this is a definitive diagnosis of an ectopic. Okay, now moving away from the tubal, let us talk about the angular interstitial and the cornual pregnancies. Actually, interstitial is different, but angular and cornual are often used as synonyms. Now, the pregnancy which was earlier called cornual is called angular. And can we differentiate between an angular pregnancy and an interstitial pregnancy?
Yes.
Can you help us with this, Dr. Lilburns?
Yeah.
So let us look at how the blastocyst implants in an angular pregnancy. So that is most important, where you have a location of the gestational sac is along the lateral superior angle of the uterine cavity. So of course we have to first suspect on a 2D, because everybody is doing a 2D, and of course 3D helps us, giving us another dimension. That's the C plane, what we are seeing here, that is implantation of the gestational sac as shown by a diagrammatic representation on the right side of the screen, showing you the angular placement of the gestational sac. This is primarily an intrauterine pregnancy. This we have to understand. And then on laparoscopy, it will show an asymmetrical enlargement of the uterus and that there is lateral displacement of the round ligament, whereas in interstitial pregnancy, there is medial displacement of the round ligament. So coming to interstitial pregnancy, looking at this particular coronal section, the 3D coronal section of the uterus, showing you a ring-like structure, which is demonstrating the presence of an interstitial pregnancy. This sac is seen 1 centimeter lateral to the lateral edge of the endometrial cavity. You see the endometrial cavity ending here? This is what is called the interstitial part of the tube, fallopian tube, the part one. That is, the tube starts from the uterotubal junction, traverses the myometrium, reaches up to the uterine serosa, and as it reaches this uterine serosa, that part of the tube is called the interstitial part of the tube, and that is where the interstitial pregnancy is located, and it is an ectopic pregnancy. So this is how sometimes you may have difficulty in differentiation on ultrasound, but 3D can add us. There are certain situations even 3D is sometimes difficult. So on laparoscopy, people have seen opening up interstitial pregnancies which have turned out to be angular pregnancy. Now coming to the next slide, which has been projected in front of me, you see the 2D sections. These are the 2D sections of the transverse section of the uterus, showing you the endometrial cavity here, which shows you an eccentrically located gestational sac, which is having a thick myometrium around it. Now this is the angular pregnancy. Coming down on the left side, the 3D shows you the placement of the gestational sac at one of the angles of the uterine cavity or the endometrial cavity, which is in continuation with the rest of the endometrial cavity. So this is how you diagnose an angular pregnancy. Whereas if you see the interstitial pregnancy, right upper corner shows you an empty uterine cavity, and the gestational sac is located on the right side. There is no communication as such seen, and you also observe a thin mantle of myometrium of 3 mm as denoted around the gestational sac. Similarly going down, which shows you a high placed and their gestational sac is minimal or thin margin of myometrium, showing you the presence of interstitial ectopic.
Perfect. That's a great demonstration. There's something called an interstitial line sign. Can you explain this, please?
Yes. Now, this is a because the mantle, the myometrial mantle can be sometimes misleading if you're looking at an angular pregnancy or interstitial pregnancy. 3 mm, 5 mm, one can go wrong. But you have a more specific sign, and that is the interstitial line sign, which actually helps you to differentiate these two types of ectopic, that is interstitial ectopic and the angular ectopic. Now, this is a line as seen on 3D coronal section of the uterus, showing you this is the thin line on the right side, which is seen extending from the endometrial stripe, and this line reaches up to the medial margin of the gestational sac. So that is what is called as the interstitial line sign, which can not only be seen on a 3D, but also can be seen on a 2D. So once you're starting your ultrasound, once you see the displacement of the sac on one side, try to search that first, that whether it is an angular pregnancy. Two, if it is not, then search for this line. This has it's got a specificity of 100% and a high sensitivity of 80%.
So for that, usually you have to go a little beyond the transverse section, so semi-coronal section. And this actually is, if I'm not wrong, is the interstitial part of the tube, isn't it, Dr. Laravan?
That's the interstitial part of the tube. And it's a stripe which connects the two, you know, the gestational sac and the endometrial cavity. So that particular stripe can be seen in 2D. You have to go much beyond the fundus to actually see this particular line.
Can you, along with that, also tell us that what is the difference? Why do we really need to differentiate between two? Is there a difference between in the prognosis and the management?
Certainly, there is a difference between the management and prognosis of the two. Because in angular pregnancy, it can be managed expectantly, right? We do understand that there are complications like hemorrhage, like placenta accreta, or people have high chances of miscarriages in angular pregnancy, but then in about 50 to 70% of pregnancies can show a normal outcome. People have shown a normal outcome in angular pregnancies, whereas an interstitial pregnancy needs either to be managed by local or by medical management, that is by methotrexate, or would require a surgical management. Now, in interstitial pregnancies, they say if you have an interstitial pregnancy which is small and closer to the uterotubal junction, can be managed well with medical therapy, whereas the ones which are larger and ones which are away from the uterotubal junction would better be managed surgically.
Perfect. That's a great guideline. So expectant management for angular pregnancy, you can keep on seeing. If it grows inside the uterus, you can continue with the pregnancy. And if it's an interstitial, it is best to intervene at the earliest to prevent any fatality. That is great. Coming to the third thing that we were discussing, coronal pregnancy, can you tell us something about this, Dr. Kuldeep?
See, what happens is when we weren't that smart enough, when we weren't having, if any one of you, I don't know whose screen is it, if you can just move the arrow on the uterus 3D so that it will be a little more comfortable for everybody to understand. So when we were not smart enough with our 2Ds and we weren't knowing where exactly is the gestational sac, and we used to just angulate our probes, or we used to just span it towards one side and feel as if the gestational sac has gone one side. That's why in the days of 2D, we had always that confusion. Am I looking at an angular pregnancy, or am I looking at an interstitial ectopic, or am I looking at a coronal? And at that time, coronal would mean coronal part of the tube. But now with 3D, with these wonderful coronal sections, we know the right horn is empty, the left horn has a nice gestational sac over there. And so if you're looking at a bicoronal uterus or a septate uterus and you're finding a pregnancy on one side, that is termed as coronal, and it has nothing to do with in terms of an interstitial or an angular pregnancy. So we're going to be dealing with the management and all that, because we're looking at Dr. Alka's screen, so we're going to be having those slides later. We'll follow that up.
You are looking at my screen.
Okay, perfect, ma'am.
I'm going to continue with this with you only. Do you think that with this abnormal pregnancy, with this coronal pregnancies, can we diagnose them later in the second trimester, or is it necessary to do it in the first trimester?
It's going to be difficult. If I can have the previous slide, it's always difficult. See, you're looking at a small gestational sac, you're doing a nice 3D formation, you can easily see the endometrial reaction on the other side. But the moment you're looking at 20 weeks or even more, 28 or 32, this empty horn is not going to be growing as much as the other one, obviously. So you could be missing out. You could be suspecting, am I looking at some sort of a fibroid, if you're not aware of this condition. So it's always a good idea during your dating scan to see, do a 3D, or otherwise try and span the complete uterus so that you don't miss out on this entity of a coronal pregnancy. And it's very important, because you need to know which side is it, how big is that coronal, because that is where the management is going to be. And that's what's going to decide whether do you need how much of support. If you're able to give a cerclage, you can take these pregnancies even 32, 34, or even a little more after that as well.
If the pregnancy is in the rudimentary horn?
Well, again, that becomes difficult because depending on whether it's continuous or not, then we've seen so many times it does not grow that well. That's always a problem in the rudimentary horn.
So probably if it is in the rudimentary horn, I think it's a surgical intervention.
Absolutely. Because it's always difficult for that horn to grow up to even go up to 28 weeks, and that dilemma is always going to remain, and it's going to be as if it's a tubal rupture ready to happen in rudimentary horn.
All the more reason if it's a functional one, that could fall, it can result in catastrophe.
Yes.
Absolutely.
And on the other end, so this is one end of the spectrum, and on the other end of the spectrum, we all have seen at delivery, at least one case in the lifetime that you deliver a baby and then you know, oh, this was a big septum or this was a biconduit uterus. So they are both ends of the spectrum when you have a coronal pregnancy. Coming to one more question to you still, Dr. Kuldeep. When do you suspect a cervical pregnancy?
Again, we're going to be suspecting a cervical pregnancy. We're going to be suspecting a cervical pregnancy when that patient is not going to come with too much of pain. She's going to come with bleeding. Can we have the next slide? She's going to come with bleeding. Again, the previous one, sorry. She's missed her period. There's not going to be that much of a pain or a fainting attack to happen. You're looking at spotting, but it's not that because of this you're going to be suspecting a cervical. You need to be doing an ultrasound. But yes, the same symptoms that are happening, you need to be watchful and for. In terms of how you're going to be looking at, you're going to be seeing a balloon-shaped uterus where you're going to be having like an hourglass shape, where it's going to be the uterus on top and the cervix also, which is going to be expanded a little more. The problem always is if this is a cervical ectopic or is it a pregnancy because she's bleeding, which was high up in the fundus and has come down. For that, what's important is because it's not an abortion happening, so you're going to be looking at a closed internal os. You're going to be looking at flow around the gestational sac because it's implanted there. It hasn't disassociated and come down. So those are two major findings, and that's always a dilemma, cervical ectopic or an abortion happening, and we're looking at a gestational sac in the cervix.
So I think the next question is already answered, that how do you differentiate between a cervical pregnancy and an abortion in process? And it has been rightly been pointed out that the cervical pregnancy is eccentric, there is no vascularity around, there's a lot of vascularity around, and the sac is regular and the internal os is closed. As compared to, I'm sorry, Dr. Alka, I've taken up your question has been taken up, I'm so sorry for that.
Dr. Kuldeep.
Can I add?
Yeah,
one more point. Please do.
If you push upon the cervix,
yeah,
through a sliding sign, there is the abortion in progress will glide against the cavity, the cervical canal. Whereas the cervical pregnancy, since it's implanted, stays there. So, positive sliding sign for abortion in progress and negative sliding sign for a cervical pregnancy.
Perfect. That's a great. So that means, in spite of the patient will be in a severe pain, but in spite of that, a gentle dynamic examination is required.
Yeah, absolutely.
Perfect. How do you manage a cervical ectopic, and what is the risk?
You can do a conservative management. You're looking at, though I'm not from the management side, but yes, that's what these slides are helpful. We could be doing a methotrexate, a local or a systemic, just so that it becomes smaller. You could be looking at KCL. You can do a uterine artery embolization. We have those surgical managements where you can do a local hysteroscopic endocervical resection. That also is being done. Some say you can do a DNC with a cervical tamponade. If required and she bleeds profusely or we land up into hassle, you could do a hysterectomy, you could do a conization, or whichever way you can, a cone resection. All that depending on from case to case, how much is the problem, how big is the pregnancy, and does the conservative management fail or not, is where you're going to decide when to switch over to surgical management.
So the factors that affect the management are, one, the size of the pregnancy, and two, the need of the patient, because if she still needs a child, you have to try all the other methods rather than hysterectomy to save her uterus, correct?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Coming to the scar pregnancy, with the rising incidence of cesarean deliveries, we know that the scar pregnancies are increasing and we're seeing a lot of them. Can you tell us, Dr. Ladburns, how do you diagnose a scar pregnancy on ultrasound?
First of all, I would stress on the history. We must take history. We must talk to the patient, which we as radiologists are not used to. So in my last webinar, I stressed upon history. So once you know this has been a previous C-section, please, even if you do not come out looking at uterus and adenexa and that's all, must try to look at the scar. That's very, very important. You may miss it. So one point. Secondly, how you see it, that is, first of all, the endometrial cavity will be closed and empty. And secondly, the cervical canal will be empty. And then the gestational sac is embedded in the scar or into the scar, on the scar or into the scar. So it could be either endogenic or active. So there are two types of cesarean scar pregnancy. So if the most important thing is we need to differentiate the endogenic type from the exogenic type. Second thing is that on color Doppler, it will show vascularity because obviously it's a trophoblastic reaction. And again, the sliding sign is there for the contents, the way I showed you that you will have the abortion in progress will show you sliding sign, whereas this will not show any sliding sign because it is adherent to the scar. And then now coming to the insertion of the implantation of the gestational sac, we need to see the myometrium surrounding the gestational sac. You will hardly see any myometrium, thin myometrium between the gestational sac and the bone. And now we need to differentiate between the endogenic and the exogenic. Now in the endogenic ones, here the C-section scar pregnancy progresses to the cervico-isthmic area, whereas the exogenic type invades deep into the scar and it progresses towards the bladder into the abdominal cavity. Now, why to differentiate is so most important.
Adding to the prognosis.
Yeah, please do that.
Please do. In cases of endogenic scar pregnancy, which go inside, so they can sometimes continue as intrauterine pregnancy and end up with adherent placenta, and we continue. The prognosis is better. But in cases of the exogenic type, which grow towards the bladder and outside into the abdomen, the prognosis is poor and they end up with rupture and rape prognosis. But we may need an MRI and further evaluation to assess the complete situation.
The message there is, from these two questions, is that the scar pregnancy, when you say you don't always need to be panic, there can be a pregnancy which is over the scar, as has been rightly explained, and that over the scar means the trophoblastic tissue is in the scar. These pregnancies can grow intrauterine, and they only have an adherent placenta as the major complication. Whereas the pregnancy which grows in the scar, in the niche, it is these pregnancies which are the gestational sacs are seen very close to the bladder. There's hardly any myometrial wall at times, and this can end up into rupture. These pregnancies, can you grade them, Dr. Kuldeep?
Ma'am, I just wanted to point another thing. Can we go two slides behind to show the pictures of the scar pregnancy, one behind this?
Please. Yeah.
So if you see over there, ma'am, whenever we're looking at a scar pregnancy, quite often you're going to be seeing a beaking sign going towards the scar area.
Yes.
So that is something which the moment you look at it, you know you're not looking at a cervical because that's much more oval around it. And whenever you're looking at a scar pregnancy, you're going to find a beak sort of a thing. It's a pregnancy trying to go in the scar. So that is one of the positive signs which
tells. That's a very important sign. Very important sign. That's great.
And that reminds me of one more sign, that if you draw a line along the endometrial canal and into the cervical canal, 2/3 of the sac would lie above the line.
Yes.
Yeah.
And if it is like so, then it is more going in favor of a CSP, that is cesarean scar pregnancy. Whereas if 2/3 lies inside that particular line which joins right from the endometrial canal and the cervical canal, that means it is more of an intrauterine.
That's when we grade this scar pregnancies, right?
Yes.
Can you throw some light on that, Dr. Kuldeep, please?
We're looking at, basically, there are four grades, and we're looking at a cesarean scar pregnancy in grade 1, where the gestational sac is embedded in less than one half of the thickness of the lower anterior corpus. So it's just entering into it over there. In grade 2, much more than that. In grade 3, you're going to look at a bulging of the scar. And grade 4, it's going to appear as if you're looking at a mass, the same way as you're looking for in the tubal area. It's just going to be an amorphous mass over there. Again, all these things are going to tell us how to prognosticate. Obviously, grade 1 is the simplest. Until grade 4, we are going to be in deep trouble. So that's how we are going to be. Can we go ahead in this? Yeah.
Yeah.
So if you see over here, we're looking at the same grade 1. If somebody can just point out the gestational sac in the line diagram, you're looking at it's not there in the cavity. It's there in the anterior wall. The other thing is it's less than half of the thickness of the myometrium. In grade 2, it's more than that. In grade 3, you're looking at a bulging sort of a thing. And in grade 4, you're not going to be looking at a gestational sac per se, but you're going to be looking at a mass. And you have consecutively successful the pictures over there of the ultrasound also being shown side by side of grade 1, grade 2, 3 and 4. So this is how we know grade 1 is going to be the easiest and the simplest. They're not going to be continuing as such, but we need to be very, very cautious. The right time to treat is what's most important. For grade 1, you could be looking in for a transcervical aspiration. Grade 3 and grade 4, you're not left with too much of choices, but a hysterotomy or a hysterectomy. We were earlier trying chemotherapy in terms of methotrexate, but we're looking at fatal complications happening and then otherwise finally leading to a surgical one. So we need to be careful. The double balloon catheter is really doing wonders nowadays. Uterine artery embolization has been tried. Hysteroscopic evacuation, again, depending on if it's one of the lesser sites. The moment the bulging starts, we know we're looking at trouble. Something major surgically needs to be done. Again, case-to-case variation depends on the need of the patient, depends on how comfortable for what thing you are. You should be trying that. That is always ideal. But in these conditions, the moment it crosses grade 1, you need to be careful of looking in for surgical management.
So, we have a lot of choices, but there is no definite consensus as far as the scar pregnancy is concerned. You have to take into consideration the gestational age, the beta HCG levels, the size of the gestational sac, whether it's endogenic or exogenic, what is the residual myometrial thickness, and what is the viability of the pregnancy. Quickly moving to the ovarian pregnancy, can you just give me one or two proper signs which would differentiate between the ovarian pregnancy and ectopic ovarian pregnancy and a corpus luteum?
The most important thing is
what it is most commonly confused with.
Most important thing is that we need to see the echogenicity, because since the trophoblastic tissue is an echogenic tissue, so ovarian pregnancy will have an echogenic mass, will present as an echogenic mass predominantly as compared to the corpus luteum, which is a hypoechoic. As you see in this particular slide, see an echogenic area. There is a small little anechoic area, and that is seen within the ovary. So it is seen within the ovary. You are seeing the ovarian tissue around it. It is echogenic, and then you should suspect an ovarian ectopic. And then if you put on color, it will also show increased vascularity.
Yeah, and vascularity will also be seen with the corpus luteum. So I believe that the decidual sign, the hyperechogenicity, is the differentiating point between the two. And these are both intra-ovarian. So both are intra-ovarian, both are vascular. So it is perfect. The hyperechogenicity, the decidual reaction, is what differentiates between the two. It is very, very common that the ruptured corpus luteum, which is again a rare event, is often mistaken clinically for a ruptured ovarian pregnancy. In both cases, laparoscopy is a must, and it is fully justified even if it turns out to be a ruptured corpus luteum hematoma.
Yeah, true.
So then coming to, again to you, so ultrasound, how will you diagnose an ovarian ectopic pregnancy of ultrasound signs, which you have already told, and now how to manage an ovarian pregnancy?
So So as far as the ovarian management is concerned, I think we need to undergo surgery because it causes a lot of hemodynamic compromise to the patient. It needs to be handled by predominantly big surgery.
So according to you, that is better. Yeah, but if it is not too big, you can still treat it with local methotrexate.
Yes.
Okay. Now, quickly to you, Dr. Alka, how and why would it happen, abdominal pregnancy?
We need to share the screen, ma'am, Dr. Alka.
No, the screen is already there.
The slides are not there, ma'am.
No, ma'am, not showing up here.
Oh, they were there right now, right?
Gigi, ma'am, just 3 seconds ago, they've gone.
Anyway, you can start.
Yeah. They're there, ma'am.
It's come back.
You're seeing my screen or you're seeing Alka's screen?
It shows you being Dr. Alka's screen, ma'am.
I cannot see her screen. Okay, go ahead. The next slide, Alka. Alka, the next slide, please. Alka, the slide after this. Yes, so you have to tell me why does the abdominal pregnancy occur and how do you diagnose?
Dr. Alka, you need to unmute.
Dr. Alka, are you there?
Yeah.
Yes,
she's
I'm
unmuted.
There.
Yes, we can hear you now.
Yeah.
So it can happen as a primary implantation outside the abdomen on the peritoneum or in the liver or into spleen, any area which can support placental tissue. Or it can be a secondary implantation, secondary to rupture of a intrauterine or an extrauterine pregnancy. So,
can you tell us how do you diagnose? On ultrasound diagnose it is an ectopic pregnancy? It's an ectopic pregnancy.
I'm not able to move the slides. Sorry. Ultrasound diagnostic criteria or ultrasound, often it's a late diagnosis. You will see the amniotic sac and the anterior abdominal wall. There wouldn't be any uterine myometrium between the amniotic sac and the anterior abdominal wall. That would suggest that it's in the abdomen. And there would be very clearly seen fetal parts. There would be abnormal lie. And these all findings would suggest that it's an intra-abdominal pregnancy. And we can further evaluate by an MRI scan.
Can you change?
I can't move the slide.
The slides will not be able to move, ma'am.
Can you do it, yes or no?
No. Not moving.
Should I try?
Yeah, please, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am.
Usually you don't have this problem with Zoom. I don't know what has happened today. Anyway, so abdominal pregnancy, many a times it is diagnosed very, very late. You may see the fetal parts very, very clearly. That tells you late in the pregnancy that it is probably an... So the patients may not even present because they don't even have severe pain. And it is because of that the fetus may grow. So the signs in a grown-up pregnancy would be easy visibility of the fetal parts, abnormal lies, and this tells you this, an absence of the myometrium that tells you this is an abdominal ectopic, and surgical removal is the treatment at that stage. It is very important that in these cases, you usually don't remove the placenta if it is on a very vascular organ. And this is a very important thing. Though this is a very rare condition, you may see once in a lifetime. To establish the placental adherence, you may have to do an MRI. So that is about the abdominal pregnancy. A quick look, last 3-4 minutes, we are going to just sum up quickly. coming back to the tubal pregnancy, what are the management strategies? Hello?
Yeah. Can we...
Could you see me? Could you not see me? I don't know.
Yes, ma'am.
We can see you, ma'am.
So just quickly tell us, what are the management strategies for tubal pregnancies? And in which cases do you do a medical management?
Well, ma'am, the medical management can be done with methotrexate. And I hope the slides are not dead, but I'm just speaking.
Yeah, but if Dr. Alka can just switch off her screen because she cannot move, so I can, yeah, then I will go for a screen share. So, yes, go ahead. Can you see the screen?
Yes.
Okay. Yes.
So, go ahead, please.
So you can have an expected management, you can have medical management, and you can have a surgical management.
So in which cases you would prefer an expectant management?
See, it depends upon whether the patient is stable. This is for...
So it depends whether the patient is stable, the size of the lesion, the mass, if it's less than 2 centimeters, there is presence or absence of cardiac activity. So those without any cardiac activity are suitable for expectant management. And there is high resistant flow. So there is less diastolic flow. So that means it's less vascular. Those kind of patients are suitable for medical management. And minimal or no pleural fluid in the POD. And what is the beta IgG cutoff? It's 2000 is the cutoff, but we ideally prefer between 1000 to 2000. And of course, low progesterone is better for medical management than a high progesterone.
Perfect. And 3D does help in this because when you do a 3D, when you do a power Doppler and you acquire a volume, you can get the 3D power Doppler indices. And with the expectant management, if these values are decreasing, that is when you say that the patient is not in a risk. But if these values are increasing, then you might have to intervene. We don't go into more details of that, but it has a very good success rate. In fact, the literature documents that 70% of the tubal ectopic pregnancies have a tendency to resolve on their own. So even if you don't intervene, they are going to resolve, and therefore expectant management is important. Dr. Kuldeep, can you quickly tell us when would you prefer a medical line of treatment?
Absolutely, ma'am. The thing is, again, we divide these into two types of candidates. One is a good candidate, one is a poor candidate. If you find the candidate is hemodynamically stable, she can come in for repeated checks when and whenever required. It's a small mass, which is again a little debatable. They used to say less than 3.5 or more than 3.5 centimeters. With a beta HCG, less than 3000 is ideal. Up to 5000, they say it could be a poor candidate. More than 5,000, definitely not. And if you're sure that there is no intrauterine pregnancy, you go ahead with it. But it's absolutely contraindicated if the patient is hemodynamically unstable. If you're looking at more than 5,000, they say more than 6,000 also, depending any sensitivities, any sort of major renal or hepatic problems, peptic ulcers, you're not supposed to be. Anyone with immunodeficiency, you're not going to be looking on. And there's a complete list which you all can read in terms of if there's any medication of this sort going, you're not supposed to be looking at them. So perfect. These are the ways where you need to be careful of.
Yeah, so, and it can be treated locally or systemically. How will you treat it locally, Dr. Alka?
So in local therapy, we can
please be short and absolutely the message, right? Because we have already overshooted the time.
So we have got two options. Common choice is to give 25 milligram of methotrexate injected directly into the gestational sac, or we can have 3 to 5 milliequivalent of KCL. That is also equally effective. And the treatment is recommended in asymptomatic patients with serum beta HCG levels between 1000 to 2000 IU. And with a tubal diameter of less than 2 centimeters and with absent cardiac activity.
Or you can also give systemic multi-dose therapy, right?
So multi-dose therapy, methotrexate, which is given in the dosage of 0.1 milligram per kilogram on alternate days. So day 1, 3, 5 and 7 to a maximum of 4 doses, and leucovorin rescue therapy at a dose of another dose on alternate days along with. For patients with larger ignets and masses, more than 5,000 IU per ml, we have to give a different regimen.
Yeah, so and if you're giving a single dose, you can give 50 milligram per meter square, and usually that suffices. Acute abdomen, if you find before missed period, would you still suspect an ectopic pregnancy, and where?
Definitely, ma'am, that has to be thought of, because if somebody can just point out, especially in this isthmic portion, where it's the one of the thinnest portions, and the moment we've now such sensitive tests which tell us about the beta HCG is quite early. But even if she's not missed her period on day 26, day 25, if she has a little early cycles, she's coming to you with acute abdomen, think ectopic always. Don't say today's the 25th day, I'm not going to be thinking of it. Isthmic portion can go prop anytime.
Okay. And what do you mean by pregnancy of unknown location?
Pregnancy of unknown location means that you don't, once you do a transvaginal ultrasound, you do not see a pregnancy either in the uterus nor in the adnexa. This could be situations in where you have a very early pregnancy, which intrauterine pregnancy, which has not come up yet, or it could be a failed intrauterine pregnancy, or it could be an early ectopic pregnancy. So this is one thing which is very important. Once you have a positive beta HCG test, patient is in pain, you do not see anywhere. So please see the uterus and the adnexa very, very carefully. See all the tubal and the non-tubal sites very carefully. Do a TVS and do a TAS also, along with both the tests.
And
transabdominal and transvaginal should be done together.
To and look you won't find right? anything, the answer is the follow-up, right?
Yeah, and if you don't find, certainly call her after 48 hours. Since the beta HCG there and correlate with your serum hormones and try to locate the pregnancy after 48 hours.
Okay. If it's a heterotopic, what is a single line tip for the management?
Single line tip is to save the intrauterine and try and deal with the extrauterine, which is usually done with a local injection of methotrexate or KC.
Perfect. Thank you very much, my panelists. You have done a great job.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you very much. And I hand over the session back to Waseem.
Thank you, delegates, as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you, all the delegates.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thanks to everybody. That was really nice. And thanks for sharing those great thoughts, those experiences. Really thankful to all of you. But this is not the end. There is something more that we would like to show here. And this is where we actually stopped. And I'll quickly take you through, because people might be thinking, you know, what One Learning is, and now this connection, that the equation between our panelists today and multiple platforms. That is, again, a challenge. You see, the information is being supplied. There are a number of supply. Services, I think that can be only possible when we come under one umbrella as a one team. So that's exactly what we try to do with the one platform, wherein you have all the experts under one roof, wherein you can take their advices, their feedback, their recommendations, suggestions. And with this one platform, you have the subscription model, which is a pay as you go, because we try to consider that ROI factor, because every technology that we buy, it's an investment, and the money is involved, the time is involved. And nowadays, it's not only about ROI, which we have put up there, the return on investment. I think it's also at the same time return on the expectation that we have, that we may have from the program or from the technology. So that one platform actually gives services all the needs. And you get to connect with all those people from the different facets of, industry, with different experiences under one roof. And you can always take their suggestions, help, recommendations, and all that. And then the material which is actually getting published on the website, it's totally coming from these people. And then the next one, the case studies, which is more of where we try to bring that interactive sort of case representation, today what was happening throughout this discussion, it was not that one way, one mode of traffic, one way of traffic. There are multiple people getting engaged and talking different experiences, different cases. So that's exactly that sort of concept we try to bring into all these case studies, just to ensure that engagement is there between the learner and the content. Otherwise, that monotony takes over and you lose the interest. I think it's just a waste of time. It's just a waste of money. And this is where we try to play around those methodologies, those interactive things, so that we could create some more engaging content for our learners. And this is purely scenario based, the role agnostic approach. Maybe somebody from radiology, somebody from gynecology, obstetrics. So you have those role agnostic learning curriculums defined in it, and whatever may be of your interest area, you can just pick that up as part of the subscription plan and go accordingly. So that means that whatever is your need, you can accordingly go forward with that. Then there was one thing that we thought through was consulting services, which is more of by bringing together all these experts under one roof. What we could provide here was more of those expert advisors, that once you are done with these case studies, these scenario based cases, there may be certain things like a lot of things were covered in today's discussion, but still, if you look at the Q&A part, there will be many questions. I think we had more than 15-20 questions even today, right? So this is this is a part of the process. Even how engaging the content, there may be certain questions, certain doubts that may arise, and this is where we try to support you with these consulting services, which is a strong knowledge kind of engine, wherein all the experts are on the the drivers of the engine actually, from which you get the expert advices, right? And it's a wide range of service portfolio that we cover here. Then the One Help Desk, this is more of the help desk, wherein you can always shoot your queries, and which is purely an SLA driven model. The service levels we have, we're bound with some service levels for those subscriptions, that any queries which are coming to us, for example, you have an image of ultrasound and you may have certain doubts or queries around that, and you may want to send that and clear your doubts, and this is how you can reactively reach out to us, and we can get back to you within that time frame with those findings from our side, from experts. And on top of that, this is also topped up with the AI approach, which is the artificial intelligence, wherein we have a artificial intelligence chatbot. You can talk to that. We call that Myra. You can talk to her and ask her questions. Myra will actually try to respond as many as possible. But in case you don't find that is not sufficient data for you, then there is a reactive approach that I said, that you can put up your queries, and we will get back to you within that SLA. Then comes the next one, which is best practice sessions, which is more of an advisory service from the healthcare pioneers, wherein they already have experienced on some proven practices, expert advisors, known, or maybe I would say which work well and are proven actually. And then this is where we leverage these best practices, some sort of advisory, the world-class ultrasound practices. Maybe in tier one cities you may find the reportings with the tier one doctors may look like much more crisp, or maybe have some additional thing that may not be the case with the tier three city, right? So just to fill those gaps, in terms of if everybody is updated on those clinical applications, the methodologies, the findings and all that, and of course the technology, are we using our technology in the right way, right? So that's been covered under this best practice sessions, wherein you can know all the what's, why's and how's in terms of the technologies, methodologies, the technology from directly from our healthcare thought leaders who have a bigger influence in terms of the technology and this, those sounding principles. So that's not all. I think we can have a look at the website, maybe just to take that real time feel, and I may want to show you that this is how exactly this looks like on the website. You see this onelearninghealthcare.com is the URL, and you see these nice case studies which are the interactive way of learning these cases, the scenario based cases from different doctors in the healthcare industry. And below to that, you can also see who the mentor concept, the advisor. The advisors are here, Sonal, Dr. Sonal, Dr. Kuldeep, Dr. Ladban, and there are many more as well. And then you can also have a look at the trending solutions, the solutions which are mostly in the trend. There are certain AI-based algorithms that we have used here, that how an end user is approaching towards our solution. So we this is how it actually sets the trend on the back end. And that's how we want to put it up, because we don't want to enforce what we do. We want our learners to pick what fits their need, right? So that's how exactly those algorithms are designed here. And then on below that, you can also see the newsletters. And this is not going to be the newsletter that you may be getting from number of companies, be it product or some other companies. It is more of what we try to do is we try to combine all the information coming from different resources and putting our data intelligence on that and making it crisp, precise, so that in a short span of time you have that one pager kind of thing and you can consume all the information. So that's for the ones who are the text lovers, who love to read the text. But then we also have an option, what we call that global monthly video update. Now, if you like to consume mostly these updates in the video format, we create that global monthly video update, wherein we are actually bundling all the updates in the newsletter format, but that's a video newsletter sort of thing. And you can also watch that over the mobile phone, the tablet, and how your comfort is. And then you can also see the upcoming events here. And the best part about it is there is the gamification that we try to put up in every learning course. So while you are while you are learning, you also have some fun at the same time. So this is where we try to put that gamification concept. You can visit our website and see that how this games. Work, and these are actually what they are totally associated with the topics which are there, and you can always go through them and pick the game of your choice and then go through that. I think that will be all from my side, but before I end, one more thing is, we are also working on that vernacular, wherein we are bringing the content in multiple languages, because that is going to be the future, especially how we see the India progressing in terms of the digital. And it is somewhat similar to what happened in Europe. You pass through every country in the Europe. What changes is the language changes, the people change, the culture changes, the food changes. So it is somewhat similar in India, wherein we have a lot of diversity, a lot of cultures, a lot of other things, and then getting almost 20 plus languages spoken all across India. So we're also focusing on that vernacular concept, wherein the trainings could be also brought to you in the languages that may make you comfortable, in case that is a requirement for you. So from here, I would hand it over to Khushbu, who can take us through the plan and pricing and how we could go about it, and maybe tell us the speaker concept as well. Over to you, Khushbu.
Thank you so much, Wasim, and I'm sorry for this technical glitches actually, but we'll sort it out from the next time. And then I'll just take you through quickly with the website, because then we'll see if we have time, then we can do a Q&A session as well. So in this, like as Wasim rightly said, this we have created as a common platform. As we know, education and training is an art, but we require, a good people to design it. So that's why that's actually, whole idea of, approaching all of the, ultrasound gurus in India. And then, we have created with the help of them, we have created this common platform for all the ultrasound users. So we have created a subscription model sort of thing. So I'll just go to plan and pricing section.
and then you can see over here the subscription model available. So here like Gold Club and Platinum Club. So if let's say you have to choose your speaker, let's say you want to take, you want to take a subscription for Dr. Sonal or maybe Dr. Lajbans, Dr. Kuldeep or Dr. Alka. So all our speakers will be available in this. But yes, you can see the offerings below. As Vaseem rightly said, we have a case studies available. So all these offerings are mentioned here. You can always go through and serve our website and just have a look on all the offerings. So case studies, little bit more I wanted to put, because as you have seen in today's session, what we have actually taken a topic on ectopic pregnancy. But then we have started discussing about the diagnosis, management, prognosis and everything like we have covered. So in these case studies as well, we are going to cover each and everything. If you are seeing and you are picking up any topic out of this, if I'll go to the One Solution page and see, so definitely you can actually get all the information related to that particular anomaly, starting from the patient symptoms, diagnosis, management, prognosis, and also we are creating facts and incidents. We have also tried to incorporate few machine settings as well in this case studies, because this will help you when you do this type of cases in your machine, because that's again a pain area. And I'm coming from a healthcare background, from the ultrasound background, in a technical way we thought to introduce few standard settings also in this case study. So that's what we have done that, and I hope we are not perfect, but yes, we are just trying to create something different so that it will be really helpful for all of you. And then the idea is just to create a very strong knowledge-based platform which will be helpful for all of you. It's not it's not only limited with the women's health, but yes, we are going to target a lot of areas: musculoskeletal, peripheral, small parts, general abdomen. Then we'll be introducing cardiology portion as well. Then we have a lot of game-based learning concept, you can click it and you can play a few games related to ultrasound, not a normal game, but yes, this will give you a complete feel of playing games, but it will be keep asking you about some ultrasound questionnaires. So let me just go through the today's event. If you go to our website and see in the events plan, so here we have created a separate section for all the speakers. You can see, so this one, if you see Dr. Sonal's subscription, summary, we have summarized actually in this particular form. So let's say if you click it over here, so in this subscription, she is going to support us one session in a month, additional to that case studies. So in this actually, this will, to make it more interactive, we have actually focused on more on 3D, 4D workstation classes. So we'll start with the gynae and IVF thing, and then we'll proceed for a little bit obstetric tips and tricks. So that we will do throughout the year once in a month. And also along with that, after every webinar, you will get that evaluation sort of thing through game-based learning. So once you will do your evaluation, then only you'll go for the next webinar. So this is something we have tried to create a structured training program so that it will be helpful for all of you. Because it's not if you are joining and you are competing yourself. But yes, we are, from our team, we will try to, put lot of effort, once you will join, we'll be ourselves to be engaged with you with a lot of interactive games on the particular topic which you are interested in. So that's all about One Learning, and I would request all of you to come to our website and just have a look have a offering. You can look also the offerings also. From tomorrow, our website will be live, so you can start subscribing for your speaker. You have to select plan and pricing, and you have to go to subscribe now. Let's say I'll just give you one demonstration so that it will be easy for you to understand. So once you go to the subscribe now, you have to choose your mentor, any doctor, whom you want to take in your field. You can simply select and go proceed for a payment. So that's all about.
So it's going to be academics, it's going to be fun as well. They are going to have those ideas. We need to be giving more suggestions to them so that it really works out nicely. And at one place, we are going to be understanding so many of these things. Brilliant idea, brilliant concept, and I know it's going to go very, very well. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Dr. Alka, can you share a few words?
Hi. So welcome to all of you. Here you have an option to learn ultrasound at the convenience of your time and your place and your faculty and your courses. So everything can be customized and tailor-made to suit what your requirements are. All suggestions are welcome. And of course, we are all learning. We are learning by sharing knowledge. We learn from you, so we invite all inputs from you.
Thank you so much, all of you. And over to Dr. Sonal, if we can answer a few questions, otherwise.
So should I open the chat box?
Yes, yes.
Yes, and I have actually answered when all these things were given, being done, I have answered a few questions by typing.
Great.
Because they have two options, they have answer live and answer type answer. So I am just shifting over a few questions to my panelists, if they can help. Please explain the double decidual sign. Dr. Ladwins, because you only talked about it, please tell about that.
The double decidual sac sign is seen in a normal intrauterine pregnancy. So whenever the blastocyst implants into the endometrium, it is sub-endometrial location and it is exenteric, as I told you. So you have three things. That is, one is whenever the sac is implanted, that portion where it implants is called the decidua basalis, whereas the rest of the decidua, which covers the rest of the sac opposite to the decidua basalis, is called decidua capsularis and the decidua parietalis. So this is how you see a double decidual sac sign.
Okay, so if only hematosalpinx is seen, no separate echogenic mass seen, then how to manage according to the size criteria? Does anybody want to answer? Dr. Kuldeep or Dr. Alka? I think if the mass, adnexal mass is not seen, then the hematosalpinx, I mean, number one.
Do other causes also.
Yeah, number one, hematosalpinx or pyosalpinx, you cannot diagnose an ultrasound, this one. It is only thick fluid inside. And two, if you are not seeing a mass, you do not have to suspect an ectopic. Yeah, it may be rarely a tubal abortion.
Yeah,
maybe rarely a tubal abortion, but in that case, you should be able to locate the sac outside the tube also. So an abdominal pregnancy sort of a picture, but along with the history of amenorrhea and positive beta acid.
In terms of, there's no criteria of a size when to do what. But if the beta HCG is not correlating and we know this is not going to be going towards that, and if we figure out an intrauterine, that's always better. A hematosalpinx or a pyosalpinx is not a reason that there has to be an ectopic always. Plus, if it's been an IVF pregnancy and they've tried out it, and if it fails this time, next time they need to be looking in for what has to be done. Some in fact do a little bit prior to that as well.
Dr. Alka, in heterotopic pregnancy, can we follow medical management of ectopic?
No, I think it's better to medical management of ectopic injection.
Injection.
The same thing that Dr. Alka said, we need to be careful of the intrauterine. So we need to save that. That's perfect.
Focal injection.
When patient's presentation is such of an ectopic, I don't know what is that question, that's just that much sentence. There are a few compliments for you all, and that rides informative discussion, very informative and good webinar. It would be really beneficial for many of us if you share the recorded video and so on. And thank you, ma'am, previous answer of one question. Injecting methotrexate in the ectopic, will it not be teratogenic exposure? So that is the reason. That's why we usually prefer KCL. Yeah, there is a slight risk of being teratogenic to the other, poisonous to the other baby also if you inject more. But if you inject little, it is, in a normal requirement, it's not a problem. So, an excellent webinar. Ma'am, how to identify a congenital uterine abnormality in 2D in early gestation? Whether in early gestation or a non-pregnant uterus, for the confirmation of the congenital uterine anomaly, 3D is a must. On 2D, you can just suspect it by the notch on the fundal margin of the endometrium on the semicoronal section or notch on the outer fundus, but you cannot do a definitive diagnosis without a 3D.
Or transverse section on the fundal area, if you that's a suspicion. If you're looking at two endometrial, definite endometrial cavities and transverse section while you're sliding down, and if it remains that, you can think of what sort of it is very difficult. In fact, quite close to impossible on a 2D, but you can. Unless and until it's a didelphus, you'll not be able to figure it out on a 2D. Bicornuate and septate requires a 3D scan.
There has been the same question for the fourth time. I've replied in writing twice, and I just repeat, Dr. Ladbans, how do you differentiate between a corpus luteum and an ovarian ectopic?
See, I had already highlighted, and also right. Madam has given, that all ectopic pregnancy means trophoblastic tissue. Trophoblastic tissue means echogenic. So wherever you have echogenic, it's trophoblastic tissue, and ovarian ectopic is going to show you an echogenic mass. Vis-a-vis a corpus luteum, which is going to show you hypoechoic. It's going to, you compare the echogenicity with the surrounding ovarian tissue. And secondly, if you actually see ectopics very carefully, they will have what is called as a spontaneous contrast, because we are using a lot of high resolution ultrasound. You will see something in motion, like you see it, and when you do peripheral Dopplers, you see with high resolution probes, you see the swirling motion of the blood on 2D. So you will see the spontaneous contrast in ectopics. So whenever you see an ectopic, try to see it very carefully. Echogenicity is one point which really helps. At least it helps me most of the time whenever I'm looking at a patient's ectopic.
And that is the last question. Just now, this is from Dr. Rakesh Patel. Just now, I handled a cervical ectopic pregnancy. I had given methotrexate multi-dose on admission. Beta HCG was 2800. But on day 6, what to do, given 7-day dose and today 9th day running, what to do, panelist? But you have not written what is the beta HCG now or what is the ultrasound picture, which is very important. It is very much likely that the pregnancy, if it was advanced, it would already have been dead inside. And I think we need more of the information of ultrasound picture as well as the beta HCG labels now. Is that right, panelists?
Yes, absolutely, ma'am.
Ruma.
So I think we are done with the questions. Ms. Kushbu?
Yes.
Kushbu, I think we are done with the questions. And thank you very much to all the participants.
Thank you.
A huge round of applause to Kushbu and his team as well. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you for making us all the panelists.
For this opportunity. Yeah. And it was real fun, and it was a very, very nice session.
Thank you,
ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you,
everyone in the team.
Be safe.
Thank you, everyone.
Be safe. Bye.
Thank you. Thank you so much.